Everyone, and welcome to Thorough Newspaper Analysis that is presented to you by LawSeeko. So today we are going to be discussing two articles. One is from the Indian Express and the other is from the Hindu. The Indian Express article that we are going to be discussing deals with crime and context, that shows the increasing number of promise to marry cases and the need to have a law or to understand the kind of violence that a woman might face in an intimate partner relationship. The other one is from the Hindu, which is titled as "Not So Stellar in Protecting Personal Liberty." So in this article, the author has gone on to highlight the lacunae on part of our judiciary, or the lacunae on part of our topmost court, in protecting and upholding the personal liberty of the people. And then we have our news in flash column. So if you also wish to clear the CLAT exam and be a part of the top law schools of our country, then you can have a look at our Project Maverick course that is available at a nominal fee of ₹100. We have also launched our own LawSeeko CLAT test prep channel, and the link to the same is available in the description box below. So with this, let's have a look at the MCQ from our previous discussion. As per the recent Freedom in the World report by Freedom House, India is classified as free, partially free, not free, and none of the above. The descriptive question for the day is, critically examine the different laws relating to freedom of speech in India in light of the recent cases. Now with this, let's begin with our analysis of the very first article for today, which is promise to marry cases and casteism. Now, why is this in news? This is in news because recently the Supreme Court had, in a promise to marry case, granted an accused a stay of arrest for 8 weeks after he had stated that the FIR was only lost after the relationship went sour, or after the relationship terminated on bad terms. So because of the increasing number of promise to marry cases in the Indian context, it becomes important for us to know what a promise to marry case actually is. Now see, I'll give you an example here. When we talk about promise to marry, by the term itself, you understand that there is an intention on part of the person or the accused saying it, that yes, he or she wishes to marry that person in future, right? And if I were to give you an example in this regard, let's say if we talk in the legal domain. So when we talk in the context of Sale of Goods Act, so there we have two kinds of agreements, right? So one, we have an agreement to sell, and secondly, we have a sale agreement. So an agreement to sell will always precede, or it always precedes the sale agreement. The reason being, it shows that yes, there is an intention on part of the seller to sell a particular commodity, and that there is an intention on part of the buyer to buy a particular commodity. So it is because of that particular intention of both the parties that subsequent sale actually takes place in future. So going by the similar terminologies, when we talk about the promise to marry case, it signifies that there is an intention to marry the other person in future, and it is based on that particular intention, certain activities, and in this regard, sexual activities or sexual indulgence takes place. So where sexual violence is brought up to light in an intimate partner relationship following the accused reneging of the promise to marry. So this is exactly what I just explained, that whenever incidents of violence, particularly incidents of sexual violence that arise in case of an intimate partner relationship, are brought after, just a second. Yeah, so when this is brought into picture after the relationship has gone south, then those kinds of cases are known as promise to marry cases. Now, this promise to marry case can arise in two situations, and one of them is particularly concerning, which is when rape is committed. Both of them are concerning, but this one is even more serious. Like when rape is committed and a promise of marriage is made to restrict women from accusing rape. So what happens in this case? This promise to marry, or this intention on part of the accused to marry the victim, is shown only after the rape has been committed. And this promise is detrimental. It can be dangerous. Why? Because it can actually manipulate the woman, or it can manipulate that particular female to indulge, or to be forced to indulge in subsequent sexual activities as well. And the next situation that can arise is when the promise itself forms the basis for sexual intercourse in a romantic relationship. So in case of relationships between two consenting individuals, there also this promise to marry case can arise in future, wherein the basis, the very purpose of indulging into sexual intercourse or sexual intimacy at in the present is because there is an intention to marry the other in future. Now, when we want to have a look at the jurisprudence of these promise to marry cases, so it was first brought into picture or light in the case of Uday versus State of Karnataka. So what had the Supreme Court done in this case? The court had acquitted the accused who had allegedly raped and impregnated a 19-year-old with whom he was romantically involved. Why? Because, and why could he do so? Because he had shown that there was a promise to marry that, or an intention to marry that female in future. Now, the reasoning that was adopted by the court in this particular case is a cause of concern in the present scenario. Why? Because it had endorsed the concept of endogamy. Now, what do you mean by endogamy? Endogamy actually means the practice of marrying within a particular caste. So, let's say if a person is a Brahmin. So, he's supposed to marry if a person is a Brahmin male, he's supposed to marry a Brahmin female. If a person is let's say if a person belongs to a particular minority community, then he or she is supposed to marry within that minority community, right? Now, see, this is a practice that is supposed to be, you know, eradicated from our society, right? This is one of those features that was supposed, that is believed, or, you know, it. This is one of the goals of our constitution itself, to eradicate this particular concept. And it is primarily for this reason that the right to equality and the practice of non-discrimination on the basis of caste, creed, religion have been enshrined as fundamental rights in our constitution. So on the one hand, where our constitution is guaranteeing these rights, that is the right to not discriminate against individuals on these grounds, it is particularly concerning because the very institution that has been endowed with the responsibility of protecting the ideals of the constitution is coming up with a reasoning like this. A reasoning that is, you can say, completely dipped or entrenched in caste-based politics or caste-based policies. So this was the reasoning that was given by the court. And what did it state? It stated that the victim should have known that marrying the accused was difficult. Why? Because the guy was a Brahmin and the girl was an OBC. So because there was such a difference in the caste of the two, they should have known that marrying in future could be a hindrance. Marrying in future could have been a problem. And because of this, the 19-year-old lady was called promiscuous on the ground that she should, because it was her fault. Why? Because she should have known that this marriage is going to be difficult. And despite knowing this, she had indulged into such activities. And on those grounds, she was branded as a promiscuous lady. Now, the grounds are, I have just stated the grounds, and the reasoning or the ground that was stated by the court was that the circumstances of being madly in love make promises lose all significance, particularly when they are overcome with passion and succumb to sexual temptations. So this kind of reasoning on part of the highest court in the country is a cause of concern, because if our Honorable Supreme Court indulges into reasoning like this, reasoning that is rooted in casteism, right? If it is rooted in concepts of endogamy or discrimination on the basis of caste, then who is supposed to uphold the ideals of the constitution? Who is supposed to preserve the basic structure of the constitution? And because of this reason, this becomes a cause of concern. And we can find similar casteist reasoning in Dilip versus State of Bihar. That was just, you can just say that it was an extended analysis of the case that we have just discussed in detail. And this concept was further reiterated in a lot of cases. Even the recent case that we had just encountered, wherein the Chief Justice of India had made such a remark, was also highlighted the deplorable condition of our judicial system currently. And this, again, so this picture, like this statement was also made by our Supreme Court bench, that I'll just read it out for you. So there is a clear distinction between rape and consensual sex. The court in such cases must very carefully examine whether the accused had actually wanted to marry the victim or had malafide motives and had made a false promise to this effect only to satisfy his lust, as the latter falls within the ambit of cheating or deception. So it is our very own Supreme Court that had made this statement, that the intention has to be seen, and it has to be seen whether that statement or that promise to marry was made in a bona fide or a malafide manner. Because if it was made with malicious intentions, if it was made with a malicious motive, then that would amount to cheating or deception. And to have our to have the very same court citing a caste-based reasoning like the one it just stated, like the one we just discussed in the previous slide, is very concerning, and it should, you know, steps should be taken by the court itself to literally alleviate these kinds of reasonings from our society, so as to set an example for our country to follow, right? And this is just some statistical data that you can have a look at. The next in line that we need to discuss is Supreme Court and the freedom of speech. Now, why is this in news? Because herein, what we need to understand is there were recent judgments of the court, that of the Supreme Court and other courts, that have done both. They have recognized the freedom of speech in certain cases, and they have refused to recognize the freedom of speech in certain cases also. So what, which cases were, in which of the following cases was this recognized? It was recognized in the case of Priya Ramani, which is also known as the criminal defamation case. And the other one, Disha Ravi case, wherein the concept of, this right to freedom of speech was recognized or upheld by the Supreme Court. Individual liberty was upheld in these two cases. And in which of the cases was it refused in the recent scenario? In the case of Aparna Purohit versus State of UP, which is also known as the Tanda case. Now, when we talk about the, you know, recognition of the right to freedom of speech, recognition of the individual liberty, then it also becomes crucial for us to know the laws that seek to curb those very rights. Obviously, our fundamental rights have some reasonable restrictions implanted within the provisions themselves. But besides those reasonable restrictions, or besides the kind of wide interpretation that they deserve, what are the other laws that seek to restrict the freedom of speech? So with that, in that context, there are three major laws that need to be discussed. One, the concept of sedition, the concept of defamation, and the concept of blasphemy. Now, what is sedition? Sedition was actually a law incorporated by the British. So it's a colonial era rule. It's a colonial era law that was incorporated. Why? To curb dissent. Now, the very objective of having this kind of law in the colonial era can be understood, because the British in India did not want to part with their powers, right? They did not want to relinquish their power. And from that point in mind, they sought to keep the Indians, like they always wanted to keep the Indians in line, to keep them in check, and to prevent them from dissenting or revolting against them. So because of that particular reason, the concept of sedition, or the law of sedition, was brought into the picture. But what happened after independence? The Supreme Court realized that yes, if we are to give a free rein to the law of sedition, then this can be misused by the governments to curb, or, you know, to literally prevent anyone from saying anything against the government, right? From showing dissent at all. And because freedom of speech is a fundamental right, so because of this particular reason, Supreme Court in 1962 held that only seditious acts with a tendency to disrupt public order would be prosecutable. So only those acts of dissent that can actually have a tendency to disrupt the public peace and order, to result in riots or certain related activities, could be prosecuted. And in no other case could sedition be made prosecutable. The next here is defamation. Now, this case again was highlighted in the Priya Ramani case, wherein what is defamation? Wherein we had discussed this in detail. But defamation, in short, would mean the practice of making any kind of criticism or any kind of slanderous talk a punishable offense. Now, because of this very meaning of the concept of defamation itself, that even, you know, the kind, like, if even criticizing the government is a punishable offense. Now, this is really, this can, that this should actually be, you know, sending chills down the democracy, down a healthy democracy. And because of this very reason, that freedom of speech entails the concept of criticism, healthy criticism against the government, which is also, you can say, one of the hallmarks of a democracy, that the concept of defamation has been decriminalized in a lot of nations. So a lot of Western countries have decriminalized the concept of defamation, but it still continues to exist in the Indian laws. The third one in line, the concept of blasphemy. Primarily, the kind of case, the rationale for refusing the freedom of speech in the Tandav case, and this has been incorporated under Section 153A of the IPC, that which talks about, which actually goes on to explain blasphemy. So what is blasphemy? Any kind of negative comment or, you know, the practice of criticizing a particular religion or the god of a particular religion. So that kind of speech can actually result in the promotion of enmity between different communities, between different religions. And because of that reason, these kind of speeches are made punishable. And Section 295A seeks to criminalize those speeches that outrage the religion. Sentiments of the people. So because of this reasoning, because of the reasoning that in the Tandav case, the religious sentiments of the majority of the society, majority community of the society have been, you can say, outraged, or they have been tampered with, or they have been, you know, interfered with, right? Because their religious sentiments have been hurt. So the court refused to recognize the right of individual liberty. Right, so this was the major reasoning given by the court in the case of Aparna Purohit versus State of UP. Now the relevant judgment here was the Arnab Goswami case, wherein it was our Supreme Court itself that had stated that deprivation of liberty even for a single day is one day too many. So it is very, you know, like, it is very disheartening to note that the court which upholds the individual liberty of people in a particular case is refusing to recognize the same in some other, or, you know, in several other cases. And this is a statistical data on sedition, wherein from the sedition cases have, you know, increased from 35 to 70 in 2018, and they have actually doubled in India, right? And this is a statistical data on the blasphemy laws in 2012. Ireland tops the countries with a blasphemy law, rule or policy at some level. So these were the countries that had blasphemy laws at some level of the government, be it the central, local, or central, state, or regional levels in 2012, right? So with this, I think the discussion has gone on for too long, but we'll just be concluding it within a minute or two. The first news in flash article that we need to read for today is the World University Rankings, wherein the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, was included among the top 100 institutions in the natural sciences category of the QS World University Rankings 2021. So this is indeed a praiseworthy step and a commendable step, which deserves our attention, that the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, was the only institute on natural sciences of our country that was included in the top 100 institutions of natural sciences. There have been two other entrants as well. One was our JNU, that is Jawaharlal Nehru's anthropology program, and the other is OP Jindal Global University's law program. However, the ranking has also stated that our IITs have not fared that well, because two of them have been kicked off from the top 100 list, but IIT Bombay, IIT Delhi and Madras still continue to remain in the top 100 list. The second one that we need to know for today is the Ease of Living Index 2020. So Bangalore and Shimla have been ranked as the most livable cities according to the Ease of Living Index. Bangalore for cities with a population of more than 1 million, and Shimla with a population of less than 1 million. And simultaneously, the Municipal Performance Index has also been released, and the list has been topped by Indore, followed by Surat and Bhopal. New Delhi Municipal Council has also topped among below 1 million population, followed by Tirupati. So these rankings have actually been given on the basis of the population of those cities. So please do not get confused here. When we talk about Bangalore and Shimla both topping the index, so the categories are in case of cities that have a population of less than 1 million. So in that category, Shimla has ranked first. And in case of cities with a population of more than 1 million, there Bangalore has been ranked first. So with this, we conclude our analysis for today. We hope it was a good session for you. If you wish to download the PDF of today's slides, you can join our Telegram group, and the link is available in the description box below. Thank you.